Hey, Grace Family Church, so glad you're here on your summer study. My name is Pastor Jerry from the Temple Terrace campus, and I'm excited. I love the book of James. It's black and white. It's a book of wisdom in the New Testament. I know there's books of wisdom in the Old Testament, Proverbs and Ecclesiastes, but this book here in the New Testament gives you so much practical wisdom, practical application that I'm excited to unpack that with you. You know, one of the cool things I got remember of doing was growing up with two brothers and a sister. And I tell you what, we always quarreled. We always fought. We always had things that we were fighting for. And I don't know about you, but we're going to talk about fighting today. Why is it that as believers, Jesus followers, people in the church, we start bickering and fighting? Where do these quarrels come from? You know, one of the cool things that we get to do today is to dive into the book of James, and it's gonna give us the answers we need. You ever feel stuck? You ever feel like, man, I'm a believer, but I still keep doing the things over and over again? Where does that come from? And James is going to help us with that. So I don't know about you. I don't know if you quarreled with your siblings growing up, but I know I did. We quarreled about our pants, our clothing, our food, where we slept, all the cool things that you do growing up. So who did you quarrel with growing up? You know, one of the things we get to do now is to unpack that. But let's talk about that. James chapter 4. Let's open up in verse 1. We start off with two questions in the passage, which is pretty cool. James says, "What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You desire, but you do not have. So you kill, you covet, but you cannot get what you want. So you quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God." Man, hold it right there. Those are some heavy words. And here James is going right to it. He's giving you some questions to think about, and then he's going to answer the questions. He says, you desire, but you do not have. You know, the desires that we have sometimes aren't from the Lord. They're not from God. So he's saying a lot of these quarrels come from the desires we have that are not healthy. We have opportunities to go through that. What is it in my heart, he says, that we need to check out? A Christian life hasn't, sometimes as a believer, we have internal wars we're battling. We got stuff that we're dealing with. Unresolved anger, unresolved things in our lives. You know, there's conflict that's battling in our own hearts. And James is saying that these quarrels come from those desires. These quarrels and fights come from this conflict that's waging war within. And check this out. It says here, these fights from the believer spill out with other believers, with other brothers and sisters. We need to reconcile that. And when we don't do that, we get into quarrels and fights. And sometimes we don't have the right motives. We don't have what God wants for us. You will live a frustrated life like this. So James has given us some great application. And one of the things that I want you to realize is that we have things we're dealing with. Sometimes we have jealousy in our hearts, so we fight. Sometimes we have we want attention, or we want control, or we want to be righteous over somebody, and we fight. You know, one of the things I found out that we have some idols that start building up in our hearts. Following Jesus can expose these idols. And one of the things I want to share with you are three idols that I know I'm challenged with. The first one is the idol of significance. Sometimes we fight because we feel that we want to get our way. We have a title that we're pursuing, a position in a company, or we're pursuing a different aspect that God wouldn't want for us. The second idol, the second thing we deal with is the idol of control. We fight because we want to be in control in our marriages. We want to be in control in our parenting. We want to be in control of a work situation. And then what happens? Quarrels and fights start rising up. The idol of comfort. The comfort part, man, I tell you what, that is so subtle. And I know I want to be comfortable. Sometimes we fight because we didn't get our right of way, or we didn't get the things that we wanted. And we start quarreling. There's things in us that we need to resolve. And those desires diminish, those sinful desires that we have diminish when we pursue God. Look what James says here. He says this, "When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with the wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures." So James is saying to us, check what you're praying about. Check what the desires you're asking God about, because those desires aren't producing the fruit, the results that you want, and you're going to live a frustrated life. And James is challenging us, how is our prayers? What are they? Are those prayers with the wrong motives? Are those prayers just for you? You know, sometimes they can become selfish prayers. They may hinder your prayers. Maybe you're asking yourself, how come my prayers aren't being answered? But maybe the motives are wrong. Maybe they're self-centered, and God wants you to realize that they can be hindered. You know, I remember asking somebody, they asked me, Jerry, if your prayers, if God would answer all your prayers, everything that you've asked for this year, would the world change for the better, or would your world change for the better? And I tell you what, I was so convicted because all my prayers were about me. What can I get? Why isn't this happening? And man, I have to be generous with my prayers. And the Lord convicted me in that moment. We must change the way we pray. You know, one of the things we remember is the purposes of prayer is not to persuade a reluctant God to our way. The purposes of prayer is to align our will with His and His partnership in Him, to ask Him to accomplish His will on this earth. You know, that's Matthew chapter 6, verse 10. Your will be done. You know, a lot of the things in the book of James are parallel to the Sermon on the Mount. So you're going to see a lot of the language used in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. It's the Sermon on the Mount. They're very similar to what James is saying on this passage. Your prayers to be on pleasure, think about that. Are your prayers just about pleasure? James is challenging us to think about our prayers. What are we praying for? Because I tell you what, when you have those desires that the world gives to you, you will have an unsatisfied life. The world will not fulfill those desires that you have. Only God can do that. And sometimes we are drifting and drifting because our prayers are giving us these pledges. Your adulterous life, look at this, verse 4, your adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? There's a disconnect there with you falling in love with the world, becoming friends with the world. He says, therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Time out. Didn't God say that He created the world and the world was good? But what James is saying here, there's things in the world that we don't have to agree with, that we don't have to align with. You know, the world has systems, there's strategies, there's narratives, there's a culture that is moving you constantly away from God, and God wants you to move towards Him and be a friend of God. You can't have it both ways, James is saying. You need to decide. You need to ask yourself, where am I falling trapped to the worldly desires? I don't want to be a friend of the world. But Jesus says He wants you to be in the world, but not of it. He wants you to realize that there's things around that we can influence. Don't allow the culture to influence you. You influence the culture. The culture is dying, desiring so much more than that the world can offer. We know the only solution is Jesus, and we have an opportunity to do that. You know, let's continue in verse 6. I want to skip to verse 6 because this is something that we need to hear over and over again. He says, but He gives us more grace. This is why Scripture says, God opposes the proud, but He shows favor to the humble. He gives grace to the humble. We've heard that before. That is something that we need to constantly tell ourselves. Look at verse 7. Submit yourselves then to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. As we're pursuing God, as we're humbling ourselves before God, as we're submitting ourselves before God, the enemy is moving away. He's got no business being in an intimacy with us and God. This is just a way that God is saying, as you pursue me, I'll take care of that for you. I love this invitation and promise. Look at this, verse 8, come near to God and He will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. That is an invitation, but is also a promise. He's inviting you to closer and closer to Him, to be able to walk in prayer and in confession and in repentance, a unity that, man, it's so strong that the enemy has no business being in there. Then He says, I will draw near to you. Man, I don't know about you, but I want the Almighty King of Kings drawing near to me to be able to overcome whatever the world throws at me. He created it all and He wants to be near me. I'll take that any day. Verse 9, I love this. Verse 9, because you're drawing near to God. When you draw near to God, He's going to expose some things in your life that you're not going to be happy about. You're not going to be proud about. But He says, grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Sin should be grieved. Sin should be a gloomy part of our lives. And He's saying here to mourn and wail when we sin. That's one of the things that we know that we're not getting desensitized for sin. Sometimes we feel like, man, we can just go on sinning. But God takes it serious here. This is so important, He says, that we shouldn't be laughing about it. We should be mourning about it. And that's what happens when you draw near to God. You know, Isaiah saw, man, I'm a man of unclean lips. In the book of Isaiah, as he got closer to God, he saw himself so unworthy, so unclean. But God says, I'll clean you up. When you draw near to me, I will clean you up. There's things that God is going to bring to the surface, and we need to take action to that. Let's continue in verse 10. He says, humble yourselves before the Lord, and He will lift you up. This is just an amazing promise that as we humble ourselves, His power, His supernatural power is going to lift us up. And that is so important because sometimes we feel like giving up. We feel like, man, I'm still the same guy. Nothing's changing. And God is saying, as you humble yourself, as you submit yourself, I will lift you up. You don't have to do the lifting. I'll do that. And that's such a great promise because one of the things we remember is that as we draw near to Him, He will draw near to us by lifting us up. What does that mean to draw near to God? Let me ask you this. How is your worship time? How is your time of praise? How is your weekly gathering of church? Do you meet in a small group? That's how you draw near to God. You go around the things that He has called us to do. And we come to Him in prayer. We come to Him in praise. We come to Him in worship. The other way we can draw near to God is by counsel. You know, we are doing so many different things of parenting, our marriage, our careers, our jobs. We need people around us that are going to walk with us through different seasons of life. And God uses people to speak to us. God uses prayer to speak to us. And as we draw near to Him, He's going to draw near to us. One of the other things we can do as we draw near to God is to have communion, have a time at the table with God. He created an environment, a space for us that we can understand and relive and remember the gospel, why He did it. Why is it that the cross changed everything for us? And we do that by celebrating to receive in communion. We can do that by breaking of the bread, taking of the juice, we remember what He did for us. Because it's not about what you do for Him, it's what He did for us. And that brings unity, that brings intimacy with the Lord. And He draws so closer to Him as we get to celebrate that. One of the things that the book of James does so well is James powerfully describes both the duty and the blessing of repentance. When we come to God in repentance, when we turn from our sin and we run towards Him, there is something that God is going to do in our hearts because of our humility coming to Him. We need to be humble by coming to the Lord and doing the things that God has called us to do. You know, as we continue in verse 11, you know, it talks about speaking and using the tongue. And we kind of grabbed that in chapter 3. So I'm just going to say that we can't criticize and judge people. God does the judging. We need to elevate, edify, encourage our brothers and sisters. But be careful. James is warning us. Do not slander. Don't be criticizing people. And be careful about social media. Whatever you post on there, don't speak evil about people. God is not happy with that. Be able to encourage and edify the people in your life. And I want to just close in verse 13. This is so good, because a lot of times we are very organized people. We're planners, and we want to do things that we believe God has called us to. But verse 13 kind of gives us just a great picture of what that looks like. Check this out. Now listen, you who say today or tomorrow, we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business and make money. Why do you even know what will happen tomorrow? What is it in your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. In other words, James is saying, be careful with plans without God. You know, it's very easy for us to be productive, to have a calendar, to plan to go to college, to plan to have a new career, to plan to have kids, to plan to get married. God wants to be included in those decisions. So James is saying, hey, be careful how you plan. Include God in that. Because, man, tomorrow is not guaranteed. We're here for a little bit. He's giving you a filter of knowing, a posture of knowing that we're here for a little bit. Use God for everything that you need. And I love the way he ends it here. Check this out. This is a command. It's like, therefore, we just read all these good things, all these instructions. You know, James is faith in action. This is what your faith looks like. This is the living faith. And you as a believer, man, this is something to look for, right? And check this out. He says in verse 17, it is as it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes. All such boasting is evil. If anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is a sin for them. Now, what is the good that we ought to do? He just talked about that. He gave you so many steps to do. Humble yourself before the Lord. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Be in prayer. These are things we ought to do. Not to talk evil about somebody else. Not to slander somebody else. These are the things that he said that are good that we should be doing. And when we don't do them, he considers it sin. So how is it applying to your life? What are the things that you need to change in your life? I believe you need to pursue godly desires. Change what's here, and only he can do that. Allow people to speak into your life and take inventory of what God has done already. You know, one of the things I see in this passage is what faith looks like. You know, we can see faith, and James is saying there's got to be action to it. How is that looking for in your life? God bless you guys. Have a great summer.